Okay students, let's continue. Now in this video lecture, we'll start first, I'll start with the classical set theory and fuzzy set theory. I'll compare the two things so that it will become easy for you to understand what the difference and what is new, what does it mean by fuzzy set theory. So let's, before that we go to fuzzy set theory, we'll just try to recollect what we read before, and that is your classical set theory. Okay, classical set theory. What do you mean by classical set theory? You already studied this in mathematics in your school and lower classes. Okay. In classical set theory, what you have, universal set, that is U. U is a universal set which contains all possible elements. So it is nothing but a universal set with all possible elements. This is what we know, right? And then there is set A, let's call it set A, which is a part of universal set. The set A is a part of universal set. It has some list of elements. And how do you write in a mathematical form for this? I'm just going to write over here. Now X contains elements which belong to itself, the set. Okay? A contains elements which belongs to itself. So based on some criteria, this X is an element, okay, X meets some conditions, okay, some conditions. So based on these conditions, if the X satisfies some conditions, it will belong to set A, okay. The X over here actually belongs to U. X belongs to U, the universal set, is also a part of universal set. It will belong to set A based on if some conditions it is. So now this is also, this can be also written as a membership method. So it belongs to that based on some conditions. It is nothing but called as membership method. Okay? The belongingness is based on the membership. So set A is mathematically equivalent of its membership function MA. Okay, the set A is mathematically equivalent to its membership function. Now membership function is defined as mu of A of X. Sorry. Mu of A of X is nothing but your membership function. Okay? Now, knowing the membership function, knowing the membership function of anything is as good as knowing what is there in set A. Okay? So, the classical set theory requires a set to have a well-defined properties. So, it is nothing but crisp set. Crisp set, crisp, the word itself is opposite of fuzzy. What is opposite of fuzzy is nothing but crisp. So you can call this A is a crisp set. So it has a proper definition of what it should belong, what it should contain. Okay, what this set should contain, what it have, there's a proper definition. So that's what's called as a crisp set. Okay? Now in fuzzy set, classical set theory, all the rules are well defined and they have well defined properties. So it can only take, let's say it can only take values 0 or 1. It can take only values 0. That means it is either a part of the set or it's not part of the set. Okay? So this is how a membership function mu A of X can take value 0 or 1. So it tells you whether it belongs to the set or does not belong to the set. So it's a binary logic or a Boolean logic in this case. Okay? Now that is your fuzzy set theory. Now what happens? Now what happens in case of classical set theory? Sorry, fuzzy set theory. What happens in the fuzzy set theory? I'm just going to write here fuzzy set theory. And let's see, what is it? Okay. So for this theory, a fuzzy set is a universal set U, is characterized by a membership function mu A of X and takes a value in interval 0 to 1. So here the membership function, it takes the value between 0 to 1, and this is how you write it mathematically. If you have forgotten, this is a square box. This is a square box which tells you the range. So range is between the minimum value is 0, the maximum value is 1. This is how you write a fuzzy set. Okay? So I'm just going to write a mathematical formula for this definition. And we are going to compare how it looks like. So X mu A of X as a membership function. We always have to write a membership function in the classical set, the fuzzy set theory. So here is based on some x which belongs to universal set. Okay? Now if u is continuous, the universal set, the values are continuous, you can write the same thing as a equals. Now you know this, you have done this in Fourier transform also. So the mu a of x will become a continuous interval. So this becomes integration. Okay? For any of x, so a becomes a membership function, and if it's u is discrete, if u is discrete, we have a equals, for instead of integration, what we have summation, summation of u, okay, mu a of x by x. Now this is how you write in fuzzy set theory. Okay. Now this is for, I'll write down here, this is for continuous. And this is for discrete. Now I'm just going to compare and tell you how it is different and what is happening. Okay, I hope you can see this. I'll just try to selectively zoom. Okay. Try to selectively zoom this and I'll tell you what's happening. Now, if you look at this, okay, now let's look at this over here, definition. The membership function in the classical set theory, what do we have? The membership function can be either 0 or 1, right? Whereas over here, it will belong, in a fuzzy set theory, it will belong to interval. So it can be 0, 0.8, 0.3, 0.5, anything. But it should be between 0 to 1. It should be between 0 to 1. But here it can either belong to that set, that is set A, or not belong. That is in classical set theory. In fuzzy set theory, the definition of the membership function will have a range. It may be, and it may be continuous or it may be discrete. Now discrete means it will have discrete values. The intervals can be like what? 0.1, 0.2, 0.3. This is how discrete. For continuous, it should be what? It will be 0, 0.01. 0.23, 0.56, anything in this way. Okay, that is your continuous fuzzy set. In discrete fuzzy set, it will be something like this. Two discrete steps. Okay, are you getting now what is the difference between this? So, this is what is membership function. The membership function denotes the belongingness of any value to any input. Okay, that is your degree of membership. It denotes the belongingness of any value to any input. M of x or m of z is where, or m of x is nothing but x is the input. Here x is basically nothing but your, it is your input. And the membership function we have been defining. So normally we use standard membership function, that is the mu of x or mu of s. So membership function are designed by system engineer according to the problem, how the problem is based. You can have, see, basically what you're going to do is you're going to define those problems, define the system, the rules that are regulating the system. So for that you need to study the system properly and then define what kind of membership function it should follow. So what kind of membership function should we use? Okay. Now there are different kinds of membership functions and we are going to see this in this particular video lecture. So there are types of fuzzy systems, fuzzy membership functions. I am going to tell you. The first one is Gaussian membership function. The most widely used membership function is Gaussian from membership function. How a Gaussian system, a Gaussian waveform looks like? Okay, instead of me drawing and writing this, which would slightly look bad, looking at the handwriting that I have, let's try to use some other tool. This and take this here. Okay, I'm just going to Let's see, I'll just try to draw this. See how it looks. Okay. Now for a Gaussian membership function, how would it look like? Let's try to draw this. It will look something like this. Right? This is your bell curve, Gaussian bell curve. And here x-axis is your x. Okay, there's an input. Okay. Your x-axis is nothing but your input. Right? X-axis is nothing but your input. Let's take these values of 1, 2, 3 or whatever. It cannot have values 1, 2, 3. Right? So let's take this line over here to be 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, etc. Okay, because the values have to lie between 0 to, it has to be between 0 to 1. Okay? Now the mid value over here will be the midpoint, let's call it C. What is the Gaussian function, by the way? F equals, what is the Gaussian formula? What is the formula? E raised to minus x minus c the whole square upon 2 sigma square. If you remember your Fourier series, Fourier logic in SAS and DSP, we have already studied this Gaussian function. This is a Gaussian formula for Gaussian function where f is actually dependent on x, c and u, the three things. Sorry, not u, sigma. Sigma is the standard deviation over here. Sigma is the standard deviation. C is the mid value that you have constant, the median value. And your x is the input. Okay, now it behaves as the... So C and sigma can be used to control... Basically, this C and sigma value, sigma is standard deviation, can use to control the... We can have a curve like this, or we can have a curve like this. Right? So this is nothing but your Gaussian membership function. I'm going to write short form over here. Okay? Gaussian membership function. Okay? Now, this here, sorry. I'm just going to keep this over here because let's compare a few things later. Now, after that, let's go to another, again, I'll go to a function graph. Now, I'll draw another membership function, that is a triangular membership function. Triangular membership function, it looks like this. Okay? Now, this is your 0. Let's call this part as 1. Let's call the point as 0.5. It's perfectly increasing and perfectly decreasing triangular function. So what is the formula? What should be the formula for this? If you very well remember your lines in mathematics. Now this function x is the input, by the way. This is your x and that is your input. Right? So x function f. Now what is function f, by the way? I didn't draw in the previous. Output is basically this and that is your going to be your function. The y-axis here is your f. That is your output. And x is your input, right? X, A, B, and C. Now there are three variables here after, along with the inputs. So this f belongs to what? It will be 0 if x is less than or equal to A. Okay? Now I'll tell you what it is. Now this is nothing but this is your A and this is your C part. And midpoint becomes B. Okay? And it equals to X minus A upon B minus A. This is for if X, sorry, not X, if S, it is greater than equal to x or is equal to b. Or it equals to c minus x. Now this is nothing but equation of line, by the way. If you remember mathematics, this is nothing but equation of line. The last part is, it will be equal to 0 if what? If C is less than or equal to, or greater than, sorry, X is greater than or equal to, C will again become 0. So here what we have drawn, F is nothing but your membership function. Okay, F is nothing but a set output, but sorry, it is membership function. So you are mapping the inputs to a particular membership function. So if it is greater than, if it is less than A, if X is less than A, it will become 0. Or if it is greater than C, it will become 0. Right? If it is greater than this, it will become 0. Or greater than this, it will become 0. Now this over here is nothing but, this over here is nothing but this part, the increasing part. And this over here is nothing but the equation for your decreasing part. Right? This is your what? What I told you, this is your triangular membership function. Okay. Let's grab this here. Try to zoom it. Great. Now, another membership function which is most commonly used is sigmoidal membership function. So I'm going to draw that sigmoidal function and we will see how it looks like. This is nothing but your sigmoidal membership function. That's one over there, right? And this is somewhat, we can see it is 0.5. And this is your input on your x-axis. And on your y-axis, what you have is your membership function. Now this is sigmoidal function. Sigmoidal function, how does it look like? F will depend on x, a, and c. That equals to 1 upon 1 plus e raised to minus a x, sorry, x minus c. Okay, minus a x comma c. This is your equation for sigmoidal membership function, where a and c are parameters, which basically a and c are the parameters which will govern how the slope looks like. Okay, this a and c are parameters which will govern what? How your slope might be like this, or it might be sharp, right? This is nothing but sigmoidal membership function. This is your sigmoidal membership function. Zoom this and keep it here. Okay, I hope this is visible for you. Okay, now there are other some commonly used membership function, and the motivation to use these sets is that we must be able to implement traditional rule based approach. Using membership function, we can determine the degree of association of any element with classes. If it is input, the classes are input and the output. Okay. Now there are some other membership functions most commonly used. I'm just going to draw it over here, you know, that so we can just compare all of the things together. Okay. Now there might be a dental bell shape. Now instead of having a Gaussian combination, there might be different kinds of variations. Okay, in that there can be S shape and Z shape, or also a pie shape. Now the most three commonly used. The other graphs might look like something like this. It's actually a modification to your bell shape curve. So for Gaussian, we may also have graphs like this, which may look like this. Okay, this is one of them. Okay, bell shape generalized formulas. Something different, sigmoidal. So one, we can also have, now basically over here what you can see, now in this one is a flat curve. This can also be done using this, Okay, you can have a combination of this. So it is one is like this, another one is like this. So you combine, it will also have this. This is another membership function that can be. There's a product sigmoid, there's a reference sigmoid. A slight difference between them, the equations you can check. Equations are basically you use this minus another equation so that it looks in a different direction. Okay? It will look in a different. So that is what. This can also, you can, this is also an S-shaped curve, and you can also have a Z-shaped curve from this sigmoidal functions. Okay? You're not going to go much into mathematics because you don't have that in your curriculum. Okay? And then you can have a pie-shaped curve, which will basically, you know, kind of a modification of this, it will look like this. Okay? Combination. Combination of this and this. Okay, you can have this here, pie-shaped membership function. So now this is all about membership functions. Okay, we'll move ahead and go to fuzzy logic operators. Okay, so fuzzy logic operators. So if what I'll do is I'll stop the video over here and make another video for fuzzy logic operators. Okay, see the next part.